Which were the most vocal protesters in your state, in Pennsylvania, against the fracking or the shale gas production, as you've seen in the last 10-15 years?
You say which were the most?
The most vocal, the most visible protesters.
Okay. We do see a contingent of voices. There's a broad spectrum of voices that have entered into the discussion about shale energy development, in this case shale gas development or natural gas from shale, very broadly. And again, not just in Pennsylvania, but in some of the surrounding states. They will raise a number of questions, and we're always, as academics, we're always interested in trying to find where the gaps are in the science and the voices that might help to identify those gaps. One thing that would be a point of major consideration for us is we're proponents of good science. So there are some that protest just to stop a process, and some even protest to stop research. And we would not be advocates of that. We would be advocates of we all use energy, we will likely use energy. We believe that shale energy, in this case natural gas, will be developed over the course of time, and that is very broadly the trend globally. So we're looking for partners in that process. And we do find that some of the larger NGOs are proponents in doing good science, and we typically will partner with them in that broader process going forward and trying to find those additional partners.
Did you ever see any religious leader or leaders involved in those protests, like we've seen here in Romania?
We don't see anything from a religious organization that is structured. Certainly not from the mainline or mainstream from what we've seen up to this point. It might be a few more stray voices in that regard, but I don't see any organized religious effort to make that occur in the United States, not to this point.
There are many voices here in Romania connecting the protests against shale gas, shale energy to Russia. Our big neighbor. Are you aware of any connection between Russia and any protest anywhere in the world?
Yeah, I've been following some of those stories. Certainly the media has picked up on that in a variety of different ways over the course of maybe the last 6 months or so anyway, and been trying to follow that and certainly been personally embedded in a number of these conversations here in a variety of places in Europe. I've not seen any direct implication towards them doing that. There is certainly a lot of speculation, and it would appear at this point that it would be speculation at best.
You're watching this phenomenon developing for many years. Which are the main differences that the shale energy is making into the United States compared to, let's say, 10 years ago?
One of the things that we're seeing, actually I could relate to several, but one that I would point out initially, is in places where we're watching shale energy, and in this case I'll refer to the natural gas side of that, we are seeing a very substantial build in terms of workforce and workforce development. It's impacting academic institutions that are retooling their curriculum. It's impacting the industry itself as they hire people locally. Initially, we saw a lot of people with the first wave of development that was occurring or the exploration that was occurring for natural gas. We saw a number of those individuals, because of the skills that were needed by companies, were coming from some other location within the United States where there was a history. And what we're seeing now is companies very clearly are trying to source their labor as well as other goods and services local. So we're seeing that make a big impact on the more local workforce. So initially it was 80% from somewhere else. Now it's 80% local. So again, a very positive lift. We also see, and I think it's an important point to make, that a lot of the man on the street, for instance, might think that most of the employment is with the energy company. And what we're finding is most of the employment is, in fact, partly with the energy company, but all the other contractors that they hire is a very important part of that story.
The drilling companies, the architects,
the engineering engineering firms, the truck companies, the contractors, and the list goes on and on. So there's a lot of those that are very important. We also find the regulator, the core of regulators and inspectors, that has gone up dramatically. We also find there's other indirect. So some of the other, we think about the hospitality industry, restaurants and hotels and car rental and airlines, and all those are watching increase. For instance, we have an airport that was losing its commercial airline service just 3 years ago, and now they've not only retained it, they've increased the size of their airplanes, and now they're going to add a second airline to it and rebuilding a terminal.
Where exactly did this happen? In which city?
Williamsport, Pennsylvania. Yeah. And we have other examples like that. And it's interesting to note, even in New York State, along the southern tier, some of their commercial airports are seeing the same type of an increase. So we do watch that type of development. We're also watching other things like the impact of the hotel industry and major increases in terms of the occupancy at hotels in places where that was not the case. And again, using Williamsport, as I mentioned a moment ago, as an indicator, we're watching that every hotel in the city of Williamsport has either expanded, rebuilt their structure, or has built a new hotel adjacent to it. And we have five new hotels that are now under some stage of construction or recently completed. We also watch other things like the railroad industry that is bringing in stone and pipe and other things like sand, the proppant that's used in the process, and seen major increases in them as well. So again, the story is not just the drilling side of this, but it's all the other ramifications that go on beyond that. And we've seen some very big increases, along with unemployment dropping in those areas, at a time when the broader U.S. economy is losing workforce, you know, unemployment going up. In those counties where the shale is being developed, especially the ones where it's being developed most, we're seeing unemployment going down.
There are many voices in Europe very concerned about Europe losing its factories to the United States, because the bills in the States dropped by, as you said before this interview, by 50% in some areas. So it's obvious that big industry is going to move there to cut its costs. Do you see Europe as a victim of this shale energy boom in the States? Only Europe, or also other parts of the world?
I would see it in a variety of parts of the world. Europe, I think, is starting to show some indications because of high energy costs, and not just for natural gas, but electric. You know, when you think about what electric costs would be, so we'll say energy costs more broadly. And we're seeing that. So when you look at, for instance, you break out natural gas and look at natural gas prices in Europe being five times higher than they are in the United States right now. If you look at Asia and costs for natural gas there being the spread even being wider than that, certainly the market is going to give up some of that manufacturing capacity with more predictable energy prices in other parts of the world, in this case in the United States. So we are seeing that reshoring of business coming back to the United States. We're looking at right now an $80 billion investment that is being made by a multitude of industries coming back to the United States over the course of the next 3 years. And those are announced projects. That's not just somebody speculating. Those are companies that have said, we're investing this money, and this is why we're doing it. So it's very tangible, and it's, again, it's not speculation.
Which are the industries that are coming back or just moving to the States because of this shale gas boom?
Sure. We're watching companies, certainly the petrochemical industry, yeah, which has largely moved offshore because of cheaper natural gas prices in other locations, natural gas being the building block of a lot of things. In fact, it's my understanding that 94% of the products that we use anywhere in our lives have a chemical base to them. And a large mainstay in that chemical process is the petrochemical component, and that coming from the root of that being natural gas. So you can see with natural gas prices, that would make a real big impact there. But along with petrochemicals, which is the more obvious, we also see other things. Steel being a big one, we see glass, again, high energy users. And another one that I think is interesting to watch is we had lost essentially half of our nitrogen fertilizer manufacturing capacity to other countries. A lot of that actually went to Russia because of the capacity to produce there and the low cost of natural gas that they had. So they were adding value and then shipping it back to the States. And now we're starting to see that rapidly decline and additional capacity being built mainly in the middle part of the United States where a lot of that is being used. Again, low-cost feedstock, low-cost energy, which are two key considerations with nitrogen fertilizer, and also proximity to marketplace, so you eliminate a lot of the shipping costs as well. So a real win in that case. So there's a couple examples.
So we see Russia as it's obviously a, let's say, a victim of this boom. It's obvious from what you're seeing, from the reactions coming from Kremlin and the direction given to Gazprom. You must go drill and do the fracking because otherwise you lose this train. Which other major suppliers of oil and gas do you see potential victims of this boom in the States?
Well, I think there's a I don't know that I would call them maybe impacted by it. You know, I appreciate the term victim, but you can clearly see that it's having an impact and likely will have an impact going forward. There are several Middle Eastern countries that do ship a lot of LNG. And a lot of that was destined to go to U.S. markets, or common number that's thrown around in the marketplace is about 26% of the LNG that would be put on a ship would be destined for U.S. marketplace, and U.S. is very rapidly going to be a export nation, or the potential for an export nation, but certainly not an import nation. So all that is going back out in the marketplace. More of that going to the marketplace obviously has the potential to drop price, and with dropping price, then that would add more to the list of impacts that you're referencing before. So Middle Eastern countries, several that could be identified there. I think another consideration in that regard would be when you think about Southeast Asia, and you look at higher prices down there, but you also look at high costs of doing business. And Australia would be another consideration, although there's been some recently announced shale projects there. There is a concern that the price to produce in that corner of the world, for a variety of reasons, labor being a big one, is going to have an impact on where natural gas could be shipped. And if we start exporting from the United States, if they increase the size of the Panama Canal, which is in progress, and you start exporting natural gas through there, which is going to become a reality, then that obviously could, some of that gas could go to some of those Asian markets. Japan is very interested in doing that. Korea the same. And that again could have a impact on the structure, the price structure coming from a place like Australia. So I think I'm indicating several trends that we're watching out there. There's some conversations similar to Eastern Africa. Think of the larger discoveries off Mozambique, for instance, and companies that are starting to look at some of those decisions based on some of these emerging dynamics that the marketplace is now starting to recognize.
We've been talking till now about mainly about the advantages of the shale gas and shale oil, but there are a lot of concerns, especially in a country like Romania, about the impact of this technology of the fracking on the environment. What do you think that company coming here for the very first time, like Chevron, or maybe we'll have some others, should do about it? How is it going to address this these concerns?
I don't think there's any question that one of the major things that needs to be done and done early is a broad campaign to educate a stakeholder community. And a stakeholder community, as I would define it, would be very, very broad. It would be the John Q. public on the street, you know, the broader public out there. It would be the NGO or the environmental community, certainly. And there's no question elected officials would be in that mix. The business community should be in that mix. And you can keep going down the list. So the reality is that there needs to be good science-based information on the ground as people are trying to make some kind of decisions as to what this would mean. We would identify several issues in the work that we've done in stakeholder engagement, and we do hundreds of meetings along those lines each and every year for tens of thousands of people. And one of the things that emerges very quickly are people's concern about water. Is it going to contaminate groundwater? And one of the things that we have easily seen in the work that we've done, and we've done lots of measurements with groundwater and a variety of other considerations wrapped around that, is are fluids going to migrate from depth, from that horizontal wellbore? Are you going to have fluids move up from that large depth? And what we're seeing is that's not occurring. And that is a place where a lot of people do have a concern, I think largely because of the misinformation that's commonly found on the internet and some of the advocates that are pushing that thought.
But I know that there were some incidents like this in the States involving especially smaller companies. Do you find it impossible for a huge company to have such an incident? I mean, can they simply say that it's not going to happen and assure the people that it's not going to happen?
Let me identify three places along those lines, and then I'll very directly answer your question. So we look at that water implication that I spoke to as identified three ways. One, fluids migrating from depth to the surface or to the groundwater. And as I indicated, we have not seen that. Small companies or large companies, we have not seen that occur in the United States. At the federal level, EPA will indicate that that's not happened. And at state level, state regulators will tell you that that has not happened in the states as well. The other place, or the other two places, one would be in the wellbore. So if I was talking about the horizontal or the lateral, where we've not seen it, then if you turn and come up the vertical wellbore, we have seen in certain situations where not chemicals have migrated, but the gas, not from depth, but gas in some of the upper levels, biogenic gas or coal seam gas, has found its way up the outside of the wellbore. So that's a wellbore integrity issue. Using Pennsylvania again as an example, we have seen there's about 20 of those locations within the state that had occurred in the past. And largely that has been resolved in Pennsylvania because, number one, identifying it. Number two, changing the rules and regs that companies have to operate, increasing the standards, and increasing things like the cement time, how long that has to set. Going from 1 hour to 8 hour, increasing the type of steel in terms of the certification on the steel and on the cement itself. So again, changing that whole wellbore integrity story to become much more robust than what it was. So that's largely taken that off the table. The third that I would mention would be spillage on the surface. And that's actually the place that most people don't seem to show a concern. But the reality is, when you look at inspection reports, that's where most of it occurs. Mm-hmm. Now, typically, they're not large spills like a tanker load. What we're talking about are typically small spills, 5 gallons, 50 gallons, something like that. And what we're seeing is the rules, again, have been changed in most states, Pennsylvania, again, being a good example, that now companies, when they're operating there, have to use impervious mats on the surface. So if there is any type of spill, it's contained on the mat. So that's to prevent anything from the surface then flowing down into the groundwater. Whereas when we started, we talked about something flowing up from depth, which the physics do not support that. The science does not support that. Although that might be a perception of concern, the science does not support that happening. So back to your question then, I don't think it's so much the size of the company in terms of that issue there. I think it more comes down to the inspection and the rules and regs that are in place and the transparency in that process. And that's what we found in a very large swath of the United States, Pennsylvania as well.
Are you aware of the Romanian standards? Have you read all those files?
I can't say that I've read all the files, sorry.
But as you know, how are the Romanian standards compared to the federal and the local standards in the states?
Yeah, one thing I think needs to be pointed out, which would help in this particular question, is the majority of the drilling that we're talking about, whether we're drilling into what's referred to as unconventionals with the shales, or drilling into conventionals, conventional oil and gas type plays, is there's a lot of similarities there. So the rules and regs for one are very similar to the rules and regs for the other. So drilling has occurred here in Romania for a long, long time. You're talking about 100 plus years, just like it has in a lot of places in the United States. So again, the rules that have been in place for a long period of time to protect the environment or protect communities here in Romania largely would be very comparable to what would have to occur with this. That said, there is some nuance or some difference between one and the other, and those are the places because of higher volumes of water on the surface. Some of the indications I made a moment ago, utilizing some of these advances that we've seen in the United States, and that's one of the reasons we've had conferences like we had earlier this week and others that we've done over time, is as academics sharing that information, as officials, regulators coming together and sharing those experiences, so that those what has occurred in the states can be used as an example and finding where those experiences would be applicable here in Romania, and where they wouldn't, then create, if there's gaps that are exposed in that process, trying to find the expertise to fill that. But we've seen major advances in the evolution of this technology and the regulation, which is what you're asking about, in the states, and we're watching the same thing develop in that regard here. But again, I indicate that there's a lot of similarities in the process.
One of the main concerns here in Romania, but I also know that is in Poland is the same, is about the capacity of the local authorities to do their job ultimately. Did you have or did you see the same problem somewhere in the United States?
Yes.
And how did those communities solve the problem?
Yeah, it's a very interesting point, and you've asked me several times about the Pennsylvania experience, and since I'm from Pennsylvania, maybe it's easiest for me to reflect on that, but again, we work globally.
Because just a second, we can imagine that there might be some lazy people, authorities, some corrupt ones, or maybe stupid.
I'm not sure I'm going to address stupid or corrupt, but I could talk about the overall process, which I think would be of some value here. We saw, for instance, back in 2008 in Pennsylvania, that there was an issue with the sourcing of water. And at that point in time, the government decided to step in and shut down the entire process statewide. All those that were exploring for 3 months until they got those rules and regs in place. And once they felt that they were in place, explained them to the industry, accomplished predictability for the industry as well as the public, and then move forward, open it back up for drilling that could move forward. So those are maybe that would be one easy to reflect on change. But another that I think is important that would speak to your point is in Pennsylvania as well, in about the same time, the number of inspectors that were in place at the early side of this development was not so many. And at that point in time, we had a tenfold increase in the price of the permits. So the money that came from those permit fees at that point was entirely put towards hiring and training new inspectors and putting them in the field. And you could see from that point, the number of inspections that were occurring since that point have doubled each year. So it's been a major increase in inspections. And there was a spike in some of the violations that were seen. But now we've seen that trend go the other way, which I think is a very important trend. So the lesson from that is making sure that you're matching the inspection force to the number of wells as the pace of that development develops over the course of time, making sure they're trained, making sure that the public, which I think speaks to several of the comments that you used, making sure the public is assured that those inspectors are on the up and up, and that they have the skill sets they need to do the job, and beyond that, that the reports that they write are very transparent and the public has access to that and can be assured that when that process is done, it's done correctly and there's accountability there.
One last question is about, it's a technical issue. Mm-hmm. Another matter of concern here is about the sources of water, mm-hmm. especially in Brlad area. There seems to be some problems. How did you see the companies in the States solving this problem? Because the demand for water, of course, was skyrocketing in those mm-hmm. areas.
Yeah. What we see, and again, using the example that I've been using, right now less than 1% of the water that's available within the state, and we have a fair amount of water in Pennsylvania, less than 1% is actually going towards Marcellus development. And even at the highest predicted rate by those that regulate water, they still see it being in that very low end. So thermal power generation, coal, for instance, or nuclear, and public sourcing of water for drinking or industry or agriculture, all those uses are much, much higher than what we're seeing from the shale industry. Now, that said, you're looking at somewhere between 12 and 20 million liters of water to hydraulically fracture an individual well. So it sounds like a lot of water, but when you compare it to the whole, you actually see that it's actually a pretty small number. But your point is, well, where did the water come from, or where is it going, and what would that mean here in Romania? We did see initially that there was concerns about that and the access to water. Water typically in Pennsylvania, as it is in a number of other places in the states, is sourced from surface supplies. So not from groundwater, but from surface. Now, not in every case, but in a lot of cases. We also saw that very quickly the technology advanced to, when you're thinking about life cycle of water, that as the water is used and sent down the wellbore to frack a well, about 10 to 20% of that comes back to the surface. So there's disposal issues, which we could talk about as well. But the water that does come back, now we went from zero recycling of that fluid back in 2007, 2008, to now we recycle within the state. We're watching, watching the industry as a whole, 98% of that is being recycled. So it's a major difference, and then that water is being reused, and as it's being reused, then at that point that you don't need to source new water. The other thing we're seeing is water that is already has some level of contamination in it. It could be coming from a mine, like acid mine drainage water that's been impacted over the course of history. It could be coming from a sewer treatment plant. It could be coming from a cooling tower. A variety of different other impaired waters are now being reutilized and used by this industry. But the rules and regs have to be written to allow that, and that's what we're seeing. And research is part of that. Can it be done? And can the regs be effectively modified to allow that? And we're watching both of those moving forward, and the answer seems to be yes.
And one more mm-hmm. question, coming back to Romania. Mm-hmm. Which is your feeling after these days you've been here discussing with a whole range of people, from authorities to local stakeholders? Mm-hmm. Do you see a dialogue, a real dialogue between all the stakeholders, the authorities, the local citizens in Brlad, the company, and so on? Or do you see a huge gap between everyone's position?
Yeah, I see the dialogue increasing. In terms of the depth, the reality is I see it moving forward. I see that the academic community is certainly weighing in here. Mm-hmm. It seems like the government and the NGO communities are also weighing in. And I think the public is getting more of that message as well. What we have found over the course of time, regardless of which country that we're operating in, you can never have too much of that conversation or too much of the conveyance of good science-based information, because different people come to this conversation at different times or to the dialogue at different times. So it's important to make sure that that increases, and again, as the technology evolves, as the regulatory process evolves, you need to keep getting that information out there. So I don't know if that totally answered your question, but I think the important aspect of that is there's never enough. So I don't think there's ever a line in the sand that says, we did enough, we're good to go. You have to keep that up, even in a place like Pennsylvania or Texas, or you pick your state, where there's a lot of development that's been occurring for a number of years now, and some, like in Texas, for a long, long time. There is still an active program going on to educate people with the changes that are occurring so that they feel comfortable or assured that they're going to be safe within their communities. I would tell you, I live in a community, we own a farm, and we can see from our farm, from our porch, we can see wells that are being developed. We source our water from that location, from that same farm. So we want to make sure that we're protected, our water, the air we breathe, you know, the health in living in that same community, even from a social aspect, that, you know, there's not tension within that community. So that's important to us.
So there is not a problem for your family that you have in your site from the farm, from your house, some drillings and so on.
That's correct.
Because right now, for some locals in Burlad, it seems this to become a huge problem.
Yeah, we have that, and we've had that for since 2006. Mm-hmm. We've had wells that were in a very short distance from our farm. We live in a mountainous area, so you know we have the range of things around this, but we've been able to see wells over the course of time. And I feel that with the regulations as they've been emerging, I feel with the technology as it's been developing, and the application of that same technology and the techniques that we've been talking about, that we feel protected living there. Mm-hmm. But there's something to be said for the transparency in that process. Again, good information coming from industry, good information coming from university community, which I'm a part of, and good information coming from the regulatory community, you know, the inspection and the government component, to make sure that that assurance that I spoke about before, and the accountability, which I can't emphasize enough.